President Poroshenko, welcome to Conflict Zone.
Good evening. Good evening.
You said that the war will be over when the last piece of Europe, Ukrainian land, has been liberated. Did you mean Crimea?
Of course.
It's not coming back to you, though, is it? It's not coming back.
Come on. The situation in Crimea is a complete Anschluss. It's an annexation of the sovereign Ukrainian territory. It's a brutal violation of the international law.
It may be, but it's still not coming back to you.
It has no excuse. Come on, we have lots of examples when dozens of years the territory was occupied. But at the end of the day, the international law and order should be restored.
So under what circumstances
the aggressor,
do you see Russia giving it back?
Aggressor should be punished. And but this is the very important detail that we plan to do that only by diplomatic matters, diplomatic means, diplomatic method influence, and the it would be a hard work ahead, because if the standards of living in Ukraine would be much higher than in Crimea, if the freedom of press, freedom of media, freedom of people would be high, if it would be European nation with the visa-free regime, with the freedom of business and everything, simply people of Crimea want to be Ukrainian.
Mr. President, it's one thing that what you want, it's one thing even what the people of Crimea want, but this is the real world. I mean, you can't take Crimea by force, and the Russians are not going to give it back to you. It would be like committing suicide for Putin to give it back to you. You know that, I know that, the rest of the world knows that. It's not coming back to you. Wouldn't it be kinder to tell people?
Look, I hate the idea to dispute with you, Tim, but the whole world is understand that this is a legal annexation, and the whole world, the more than 170 nations do not recognize this annexation and promise never recognize it.
But they've accepted
and
it.
If it is, that's something different, isn't it?
They've accepted it.
No.
They don't recognize it, but they've accepted
it. No. No, nobody from the European Union accepted that. We have no flight to Crimea. We have no business with Crimea. We have no diplomatic relation, no consulate, nothing in Crimea. We have limits on and zero investment to Crimea. We have this is the position of not acceptance, even not the not recognizing that.
But Mr. President, nobody in the European Union, and if
we accept and recognize it, that means that it would be complete violation and ruin the global security system. That would be the stimulation of the aggressor. That would be exactly the same like in year 1938. And I just can't imagine that somebody in 1938 asked, do you understand that Austria is forever would be German?
But Mr. President,
and my answer would be no.
I understand. But Mr. President, you look at the occupation of the West Bank and the territories by Israel coming up to 50 years. Not a single member of the European Union recognizes that as anything but illegal. It's coming up to 50 years and everybody's accepted it. It's going to be exactly the same with Crimea.
No, because truth is with us. World is with us.
You could say that about the Palestinians. You could say that about the Palestinians.
No, no, we have completely different situation. Aggressor is completely isolated.
The reality is, though, that the Russians have actually set limits for you, haven't they?
No.
Which is what they wanted to do. There will be no full membership of the EU, and there will be no full membership of NATO, because the Europeans will never run the risk of doing that, will they? Of offending
Russian paying already the huge price for the brutal violation. And this huge price is a sanction. This huge price is a situation in economy. This huge price is a situation with the gold currency reserve. This is huge price with the subsidy he should give to Crimea, and that cannot last forever. And let's be realistic. This is, of course, Russia is a powerful state, but if the world accept the aggression, the world never be the same, because this symbolize that the global security system, which was created after post-World War II, is not working.
Do you think Ukraine will ever join NATO?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah.
Because Germany
not in the nearest future.
But Germany has already said it doesn't see membership.
No.
Foreign Minister Steinmeier said last November, "I see a partnership between Ukraine and NATO, but not membership."
Exactly. Because we should meet the criteria of NATO, and did not happen today or tomorrow.
But they turned you down in 2008 as well. You were turned down as well. Why? Because Russia objected.
No, because...
And they'll turn you down again because Russia will object.
Tim, in the year 2008, in a summit in Bucharest, it was the contrary. It was the statement that the door of NATO is open for Georgia and for Ukraine. But
didn't happen.
But because Ukraine do not meet the criteria.
No, because Russia said no.
Russia
said no. The French Prime Minister said at the time, "We are opposed to the entry of Georgia and Ukraine because we think that's not a good answer to the balance of power inside Europe."
I'm very happy to know your opinion and opinion of the French President. If you allow me to mention French Prime Minister, sorry. But if you allow me to mention my opinion, so we are sovereign and independent state. And we do not ask the permission, neither from Russia nor from anybody else. Our position is to reform my country, and we need for that at least 6-7 years to meet the criteria. We should do the work which is necessary for us, and only then we should ask Ukrainian people and to make a referendum, does Ukrainian people accept and want to be the NATO member state in a 7 years time.
You still have to be invited.
This is the situation from two sides. And what the main changes it happened during the last 2 years? 2 years ago, we have a level of support of NATO integration, NATO membership in Ukraine among Ukrainian people, 16%, 1-6. Today, we have support of NATO integration for 60%.
I understand 60. That you want and it. I understand that Ukrainians want it.
Look,
I'm talking about the West's attitude. They will never, ever risk this kind of confrontation with Russia again.
You live in the today world. Can imagine what's happened in the 6, 7, 8 years. The world would be completely different. And the NATO today is the only effective security system because all other system is ruined. Ruined by Russia occupation and aggression both in Ukraine, in Syria, and possibly in any other countries.
Mr.
And
President,
in that situation, we should prove to our partners that the world would be more secure if Ukraine has an opportunity to do that. For us, this is the carrot. For us, this is the light at the end of the tunnel to motivate us to reform the country. And now we should not be provoked.
And the Germans have already said no.
And
it's
no,
membership this is not going to happen. Foreign Minister Steinmeier has made his position clear.
Sorry, this is not German. This is just the position of Steinmeier for the year 2015. And nobody knows what would be the position of Germany in the year 2022.
Mr. President, you say you're fighting this conflict for Europe, standing up to aggression. But have you not considered the possibility that Europe needs Russia more than it needs you? It needed Russia to get an agreement with Iran on the nuclear issue, needs Russia to get an agreement on Syria, needs Russia to combat Islamic State. Maybe it needs Russia more than it needs Ukraine.
Do you propose Europe to treat Ukraine?
I'm not proposing. I wonder whether you have considered the possibility
what is the European
that they care more about offending Russia than pleasing you.
That's a very good question, because what is European Union? Does it 28 member states? What united Europe? Money? Market? Russia? Security? No. Do you know what united Europe? Values. And why I'm absolutely sure about unity of European Union and solidarity with Ukraine? Because this is not a question of the beginning. This is a question of values. And that's keep.
It doesn't look so united these days, the European Union. Does it?
Not
over the migrant issue,
no.
Not over Greece, and at not the, over this
at
either.
At the end of the day, both on Ukraine, both on the Greece, and I hope, strongly hope, that on the migrant crisis, Europe would be united. In the beginning of year 2014, I met with the most of the Minister of Foreign Affairs, European Union, and I asked if it would be aggression. Is it possible that European Union can keep united and make a sanction? Do you know what was an answer? No. never ever European Union can have a consensus voting on sanctions. And I said no. In a 3 months' time, it happened. So please, let's not underestimate European Union.
Let's look first at the Minsk agreement, because it's looking very fragile in the last few days. Having had some months of calm, we've seen fighting breaking out again. We've seen shelling breaking out. The Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe has been reporting a number of cease violations. Is this going to hold, the ceasefire, by and large, or these violations are going to mount? It's not working, Minsk, is it?
No.
It's not working.
No. Look, we have a very severe dispute team. I try to be speaking with quite big arguments. What does it mean, Minsk agreement? This is just a peace plan. Nothing can be, nobody can be against Minsk, because Minsk is ceasefire, withdrawal of heavy artillery weapon, releasing all the hostages, immediate access for EC inspector to any territory or any place where weapons is kept. The humanitarian works for improving humanitarian crisis, the social and economic development of the territory, and political part of that, where we have a free and fair election to let the people who live in Donetsk and Lugansk to elect their representative to which
represent
them.
Yeah, but you're missing the deadlines.
No.
There were deadlines for Minsk.
No, there is no.
You're missing the deadline. It's being shelved into next year.
With your permission.
Weren't there?
With your permission, it is not me who missing the deadline, because Ukraine is very responsible state and very responsible part of Minsk agreement.
Yeah, but
and
you
we
say
do,
this.
And
you
we
say
do,
this.
No, we do everything we promise. This
so,
is
so. So why are your Grad rocket launchers still in territory that they shouldn't be in now, here in November, as cited by the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe 2 days ago?
No.
Yes.
No. Because
they reported
no.
it. They reported it.
No.
Grad missile launchers.
No.
Yours.
No. Because our position is absolutely clear. We are fully cooperative with the OEC. We are absolutely open for all the inspection. We
so
don't
why
have
did they
once.
Say, why did they say your Grad missile launcher was in a place it shouldn't be?
Okay,
now.
Tim, sorry.
Why?
If you allow me. Please. We have a long list of the reports, and I am responsibly make a statement that we fully implemented all tiny details on Minsk, including the withdrawal of heavy artillery and weapons.
So the report is wrong. You're saying
we
it's
don't,
wrong.
We do not have any single cases for not implementing the Minsk agreement.
So they got it wrong then. They got it wrong.
Tim, please.
But you can't both be right. The OSCE and you
please,
can't both be right.
Please. If you give me 1 minute. Thank you. We are responsible part of the Minsk agreement. We are fully cooperative with the OSCE. If you take the number of the reports on Ukrainian side and on the Russian side, this is 12, 15 more time when the Russia violate the shelling, when the Russia do not allow the access of the EC inspector both on the border and on the territory when they kept the weapons. And we have happened single case, but it was immediately removed in a 40 minutes when inspector come. We give that it was a 50 or 500 meters from the 23 kilometers when they find out the place, and we immediately release and remove it. That is the way for how we cooperate with the OSCE, and that is that when the OSCE inspector not simply not allowed to enter, but simply open the fire against OSCE inspectors.
Okay, so you have a different interpretation of this from the OSCE.
No. We have a different situation because we are fully implement Minsk agreement. And this is confirmed by OSCE, and they
Well, it
do
wasn't
not
2 days ago. It wasn't can, 2 days ago.
Unfortunately. We have the framework of the our communication do not allow me to give. But I give you immediately after that the figures.
Okay.
And
all
please
right.
show it to all the right. viewers, because this is very dangerous things. Because this is a Russian scenario to demonstrate, no.
Okay.
Both of sides violated the Minsk. This is not true, because Ukrainian fully implemented
all right.
that.
You say it's not true. Let me talk about some of the promises that you've made since you became president. One of them was to combat corruption. Just over a month ago, the US ambassador to Ukraine accused your prosecutor general's office in a highly unusual intervention of obstructing efforts to combat corruption and shielding its own employees from investigation. Why is the prosecutor general still in his office, if that's what he's doing? Why? And if you're serious about combating corruption, why are you allowing this situation to go on?
The answer is starting from two things. First thing, immediately after that, we launch an investigation, independent investigation, with a cooperation with our American partners. An independent general inspection inside the general prosecutor, launching the investigation, and but I hope we receive any facts of the corruption. And if these facts would be confirmed, no one single minute, anybody who would be accused and confirmed will stay in the position. This is point number one. Point number two, we want to create absolutely effective system for fighting against corruption. We create new anti-corruption bureau with an absolutely high level of trust in an absolutely transparent procedure for appointing the new person. And it would be launched in the 1st of December.
But two days ago, the head of cooperation from the European Union delegation to Ukraine wrote about their concerns about some of the people who were being put on this new anti-corruption unit.
Exactly.
And reminded you that EU assistance is very much, as they said in their letter to you, conditional on the efforts of Ukraine partners in the fight against corruption.
Exactly.
So they felt the need to warn you about
exactly.
this in the strongest possible terms two days ago.
And the very next day, we removed this peace person from the selection commission and appointed those who was proposed by the European Union, including, I hope the Parliament will vote tomorrow, Mr. Kassler, who would represent the European Union. So our reaction is very quick and very effective. But the most important thing is that to launch the new anti-corruption structure and new anti-corruption system immediately from the 1st of December. And the most important thing is that this system should have a trust from Ukrainian people, Ukrainian authorities, our European and American partners.
Mr. President, you want to show that the world you're bringing in a new era, you want to show openness, you want to show transparency. Why does a president need, and gets a lot of criticism, why do you need your own television station, Channel 5? Why? When the OSCE says, the top official for media freedom says, Mr. Poroshenko should sell his TV station. It's my firm view that elected politicians should not own and control media outlets in their country. Why do you have it?
That's a very good question. In the year 2003, when I was an opposition politician, I was created the first free Ukrainian media, which has an absolutely public and transparent relationship between journalists and the owner. And that was the first example.
But there is an appearance of conflict
and
of interest, isn't there?
No,
there is always the appearance when a politician.
But the
you promised to be different.
No, I never promised to sell the fifth channel.
No,
never.
But you promised to be different from oligarchs who own media in this country.
I'm different, and if you see the fifth channel. Maybe one of the most, the channel who is the most criticized, and one of the most free. This is the fifth channel. This is a very reputable journalist. And
but
why should
do you need it? Why? You're president. You've got other things to do. Why do you need this?
Look,
what other presidents have TV channels in Europe?
I'm the guarantor of the freedom of press. And the standard of the journalist and the fifth channel is do not have any objection or any criticism for that.
There's also a problem that you promised to sell your chocolate business and you haven't done it, Russian. You promised. Mm-hmm. Why?
That's I promised. Because
why?
Because part of my business in Russia was confiscated by Putin and part of my business is arrested. And it is impossible to sell arrested business.
Why? Because you lose money.
No, because it is arrested.
Okay, so you
and
can
transfer it into somebody else's hands. Exactly.
And you could transfer it into some, but you haven't done that either.
Exactly. No, we signed up already the trust agreement with one of the most reputable European trusts and transferred to the absolutely independent management. This is the way how I want to solve this question.
You still have a number of business. You promised to get rid of most of them.
Tim, you may do not like my answer, but I am the only Ukrainian president who is transparently transfer the funds to the independent trust fund with a reputable name. And I think this is a very European way. In the country in a state of war, when nobody wants to buy the business, is to separate business and politics.
You promised also to get rid of pocket armies, as you called them, right sector, the group of so-called volunteer battalions, right sector, still exists. And the power of the oligarchs, you said there would be no more oligarchs in Ukraine. The oligarchs still exist, they have their power, they've exercised it in the local elections,
you very freely
and they have their assets.
You very freely incorporate my promises. I do not promise to destroy right sector. This is a political party. But I promise to remove it from
it's
the
front. It's also an army, isn't it? It's also an army.
It's possible to finish the answer.
Yeah.
Please. I promise to disarmed and to withdraw it from the front. There is no one single representative of the right sector on the front line, and the police is, this is the responsibility, by the way, the police of the NATO president, instruct to disarm any illegal armed formation, no matter it is belongs to oligarch or to the illegal army political group. And if you would be objective, both the oligarch army is disarmed, and I am fighting with that. And the situation
but
with
right
the legal
sector has not been disarmed, has it?
The right sector is. This is in the process of disarmament, and this is not an easy job, especially in the country.
We've already seen a shootout between them and the police near the western border.
It was several months ago, and
we've
after
seen private armed militias with assault rifles surrounding
ask me the question,
chief oil production.
Team, with all respect, ask me the question, and I try to answer you. When you told that it was the conflict between the right sector and the police. Immediately, it was the military operation to disarmament the right sector. Immediately, when the right sector tried to provoke the National Guard, we have an army operation. I try to explain you once again. I am a president of the country in a state of war, where we have lots of weapons, and we try to make an effective efforts to disarm, to make a law and order. And the good evidence of that is that all the troops from the Ukrainian side on the touchline keep ceasefire and keep law and order of the commander-in-chief of Ukrainian troops.
But there are credible accusations of human rights violations mm-hmm. from international organizations,
absolutely.
Both against your troops and against the other side as well. Are these going to be investigated?
First of all, no. Because we have a completely different size of this violation, and all the violation from Ukrainian side is properly investigated with the presence of the international inspector, and all the things from this part of the border is not. And this is our difference. We are civilized European states who keep their promises, and they're bandits and terrorists. And I invite you to go there and to have an evidence with your own eyes, what is the difference?
Amnesty International said both sides were arbitrarily holding civilians who have not committed any crime but were sympathizing with the opposite side.
If you see the statistics, how many criminals in the Ukrainian army was put in the investigation and in responsibility, that would be the answer for the Amnesty International. Let's be objective. And the same way, there is absolutely no reaction from the terrorists and bandits from their side. This is 8,000 killed Ukrainian person with any responsibility from their side. This is the 2,000 Ukrainian troops, more than 2,000, killed by Russian soldiers without any responsibility. And let's not play very dangerous and dirty games that, okay, both sides is responsible. No. This is not we, but Russian attack us. This is not we, but Russian make an aggression against us.
So you reject
this
the
is
human
not
rights
we.
Accusations. You're rejecting. You said you're going
not,
to investigate.
We investigate them. And I just not reject, I said that we are different. We are cooperating with the international agency, both human rights, Amnesty International. We are open for this investigation. We are cooperating with them. And that is the very good symbol, very good sign of the European country.
President Poroshenko, thanks very much for being on Conflict Zone.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.